So far we have discussed about various cases of one dimensional steady state heat conduction. Professor Shom has discussed about those, and today we will start with two dimensional steady state heat conduction. So one dimensional problems have been discussed. Now we will discuss about two dimensional problems. Now let us give a practical perspective to this type of problem. So whenever you are solving a problem, right, in say practical engineering industry or maybe in life sciences or whatever, nobody tells you that the problem is one dimensional, two dimensional or three dimensional. So how do you assess whether a problem can be treated as a one dimensional problem, two dimensional problem, three dimensional problem? Whether the problem is a steady state problem or an unsteady state problem, this must come from our own judgment. And once that judgment is applied, then we can apply the appropriate mathematical technique to solve the problem. So let us think of that there is an arbitrary domain like this, some three-dimensional domain. So in this domain, you could have, let us think of three orthogonal directions. X, Y and Z like this. So if you look at the heat conduction equation which we derived, you will figure out that in the heat conduction equation you will have terms like these are spatial gradients, and you also have unsteady term where the temperature variation with time governed by this type of a term. Of course, rho, C, all these things are there. I am not writing the full equation, I am just writing the important derivatives. Now, let us say that you have a problem like this where there is a temperature difference imposed across a length of x reference. X reference is the length along x. What is x reference? So let us maybe draw a cuboid like this. This is x reference, length along x, okay. So what is this basically? This is this. So it is some characteristic delta t divided by some square of some characteristic length, that is the order of magnitude of this term. So when we say order of magnitude, by that we mean that what is a, like let us say maximum order. So let us say that if x reference be the length, then this is along x. Similarly, if the same delta t is imposed along y, and let us say y reference be the length scale along y, let us say this is x, this is y, this is z, So this is of the order of, remember this is not equal to this, it is just a rough estimate of its order of magnitude. So this is delta t by x reference square, this is delta t by y reference square, this is delta t by z reference square. And this is t reference is a characteristic time scale of the problem, that is the time over which you are studying the problem. It may be minutes, it may be hours, depending on the time over which you are studying the problem. So this now the first keyword is steady state. I will discuss about this keyword very carefully. So when will a problem, a heat conduction problem, be treatable like a steady state problem? When can we treat it as a steady state problem? So of course, from just a simple mathematical perspective, we can treat it as a steady state problem when this term is not important. Right? So when is this term not important? This term is not important when with respect to this T reference is large. That means what? That means the ratio of these two is small. Now how large, how small, comparable to what and what, we will come into that when we write the actual equation. But I am first trying to give you a very rough feel. As an engineer, it is very important that you get first an approximate rough feel for the problem and then you get into the mathematics, rather than start with a bulwark of mathematics from the beginning. So if this is large and we are interested about characteristics of the large time scale, then it may not be important that we consider the unsteady problem. Remember, in the world all problems are unsteady inherently, because let us say that you have this kind of a situation and initially there is a particular temperature within the domain. Now you suddenly subject this body to particular boundary conditions. So let us say you subject this to temperature T0 and you subject these to temperature TL. Okay. T is equal to TI at time equal to 0 for all x, y, z. Okay. So in this problem, the temperature from its initial state will start changing. It will start changing because of the imposed boundary condition. So what does the boundary condition physically do? A boundary condition helps the disturbance to propagate from the boundary to the interior of the domain. And how is it possible? It is possible because of some material properties. Here in heat conduction, the relevant material properties are K, rho and Cp. Or when you are talking about a solid, it doesn't matter whether it's Cp or Cv, simply C. So K, rho and C. Now if you are thinking about the change with respect to time, maybe there is some initial change because of the imposition of the boundary condition, but after that the changes stop taking with respect to time. Then we say that steady state has attained. So steady state has attained when there is no further change with respect to time. When there is no further change with respect to time, then what happens? Then the unsteady term, the gradient with respect to time, is no more important. And then you can treat it as a steady state problem. Possibly beyond the critical time, the when it achieves steady state, then you can use steady state formulation, but below a critical time, when there is a continuous change of temperature within the body as a function of time, then you have to consider unsteady state. So, no problem is perfectly steady or unsteady state, depends on your interest over the, at what time scale you are interested. If you are interested over the time scale over which the problem has already attained steady state, then you go for steady state analysis. This is the first point about steady state. The second point about steady state is that there is a tremendous misunderstanding between two terminologies, steady state and thermodynamic equilibrium. So, in many scenarios, people say, people use these terms interchangeably. People say that the system has attained steady state and the system has attained equilibrium simultaneously. Now, let us take an example. Let us say I give an example of a one dimensional problem just to illustrate the concept, but same concept can be applied to multi dimensional problems. Let us say there is a rod, this end is immersed in steam at 100 degrees centigrade, this end is immersed in ice bath at 0 degrees centigrade. Okay. So, the question is this in equilibrium? Can this be in steady state? So, in terms of equilibrium, when do we say that a body is in equilibrium or thermodynamic equilibrium? It is in thermal equilibrium, mechanical equilibrium, and phase and chemical equilibrium. When all these things are satisfied, we say that a system is in thermodynamic equilibrium. So, one of the requirements is thermal equilibrium. What is thermal equilibrium? Thermal equilibrium means the entire system is at a homogeneous temperature. Because if there is some gradient in temperature, then that will trigger a local heat transfer to take place. So, if the system had to be in thermal equilibrium, then throughout this system the temperature had to be something, some value. But here, I mean, from simple analysis you can say that if you plot temperature as a function of maybe x, this is 100 and this is 0. Okay? So, that means the temperature within the domain continuously varies with x and it is not a constant. That means this is an example which shows that steady state need not necessarily mean thermodynamic equilibrium. There is a difference between steady state and thermodynamic equilibrium. So, when we are talking about steady state, we are not caring whether it is in thermodynamic equilibrium or not. That is not of interest to the study of heat transfer. That is of interest to the study of equilibrium thermodynamics, but not of heat transfer. So, now the question is dimensionality of the problem. So, we are clear that out of these three terms, if any one of the terms dominates over the other terms, let us say that, let us take an example, x reference much, much less than y reference, z reference. Okay. So, if that be the case, then out of these three terms, which term is most important? The first term, right? And then it is as if like a one dimensional problem. Now, let me bring out a fallacious situation here. Look at this problem. Okay. In this problem, what is, this is x reference, right? let us say this is a bar which has some dimension along y and z, y reference, z reference, all those are there, those are not drawn, and one dimensional problem is solved. So, in this problem, by the shape of a rod or a bar, it is quite clear that x reference is much larger, actually the other way, it is much larger as compared to y reference or z reference, but still we are assuming this as a one dimensional problem along x, y. You understand my question? Here along x the length is much larger. So ideally if we go by this logic, then it should be like the y reference and the z reference being small, it should be at least a two dimensional problem in the y z plane. But we are considering a one dimensional problem along the x direction. So what is the inconsistency, if at all there is any inconsistency? See, here we have assumed that the same delta t is applied in all directions, right? In this problem, the delta t is applied only along x direction, in other directions no delta t is applied. So it is not just the length, you also have to see what is the delta t that is imposed, right? So here the delta t is imposed along x, so the temperature gradient will be created along x, okay. Now, so it is quite clear that when we consider steady, one dimensional, two dimensional, three dimensional, when we consider unsteady, all these things must be very clear before we solve a problem. See, when we solve a problem, what we essentially try to do is, we try to make a mathematical model. What is a mathematical model? A mathematical model is an abstraction of the physical reality. It is not exactly what is the physical reality, right? Otherwise every problem has to be solved three dimensional and unsteady. But mathematically, when we simplify a problem, we take into account some practical considerations and simplify the problem to an extent that it is mathematically simplified to the extent possible. So we will straight away get into a problem. Of a two-dimensional scenario, which will be our agenda for today's discussion. So let us take a problem like this. That you have a domain, rectangular domain, with length A along X, length B along Y. Okay. Now let us assume that we are interested about a solution when steady state has already been attained. Later on we will see that if we are interested for a solution when steady state has not yet been attained, how to go for the solution. But to begin with, let us assume that steady state has already been attained and we are interested for the solution. So now can you tell whether, so it is a steady state problem and the largest dimensionality of this problem is 2, right? It is not a three dimensional problem because everything is planar and all the temperature gradients are imposed in the xy plane. Now a similar problem, can you think of when the problem looks like 2D, but actually it's almost a 1D problem. This is a 2D problem. Why this is a 2D problem? It is quite clear that you have a temperature gradient here. You have a temperature gradient here. You might argue that where is the temperature gradient here? This temperature and this temperature is the same. But that shows that not everywhere within the domain the temperature is same, but there is a periodicity in the solution. Because there is a temperature gradient along y, and the governing equation has sum total of the effect of temperature gradient along y and temperature gradient along x. So to make the sum total equal to 0, some temperature gradient along x should come, right. So it is a two-dimensional steady state problem. We will solve this problem today, but before that I want to capture your attention by looking into a scenario when the scenario, the schematic, the drawing looks very similar to this, but the problem is actually a one-dimensional problem. Okay. Let us try to find that out. So let us say that these two boundaries are insulated. In heat transfer, insulated boundaries are often drawn by these hatched lines. Okay. You have seen in thermodynamics also that insulated boundaries are often schematically represented like this. So these are insulated, that means there is no heat flux. Let us say this is T equal to 100, this is T equal to 0. Okay. So can you sketch the isotherm lines here? What are isotherms? Isotherms are lines of constant temperature. So across the isotherm you have the temperature gradient. Okay. So let us try to draw it with a different color. So you can see that when you look into a problem, always look into two things. One is geometry, because of course geometry dictates the dimensionality. If you have already a two-dimensional geometry, there is no question that the problem will be three-dimensional. If you have a two-dimensional geometry, the maximum dimensionality of the problem is two-dimensional. But you also have to look into the boundary conditions. So here the boundary conditions are such that see, no heat is able to get transferred along these directions. So the primary direction of heat transfer is like this. Because the primary direction of heat transfer is like this, it is almost like the same problem where you have this one dimensional rod here 100 and here 0. Okay, and the isotherms you will be getting will be like this. So this is 100, let us say we draw it at some interval. So let us say this is 60, this is 40, I mean in this way it goes to 0 here. So that this line is a line where along which everywhere temperature is 60. So you can see that these lines are vertical lines, that means the gradient is along the horizontal. So although the geometry is two dimensional, the boundary condition says that the problem is primarily a one dimensional problem. Of course there again it is not perfectly a one dimensional problem. If you are a great perfectionist, it is a two dimensional problem. But for all practical purposes, the temperature gradient along y is not of great interest here. The great interest is temperature gradient along x. So now we will come back to the solution of this problem. So let us make some assumptions. So what are the assumptions? two-dimensional steady state constant properties. So if we write the governing equation, let us write the full governing equation. This is a solid, so any term related to compressibility is not coming into the picture. Now, first of all, it's a two-dimensional problem. Because it's a two-dimensional problem, this term is not important. Then, it's a steady state problem. So this term is 0, okay. Now once you say steady state problem, when you talk about constant properties, it is not necessary that all properties have to be constant, just thermal conductivity constant is good enough. Because once you say that it's a steady state problem, rho and C are no more important. So, whether they are constant or they are variable, that will not make any sense. It is important that what k is, and of course constant properties means that k is constant, and then we will assume there is no heat generation. So, when k is a constant, k will come out of the derivatives, so you will have because k is not equal to 0, so you must have this prototype is not just important in heat transfer, but in any branch of applied physics and engineering, and this is known as Laplace equation. So we will try to, so of course this is Laplace equation in two dimensions. If you have another term like this for z, that is Laplace equation along three dimensions. Now we will try to solve this equation. Now there are many methods of solution, and each method is very interesting by itself. This being the most elementary level course on conduction heat transfer, we will not start with a very elaborate method of solution. We will start with one of the simple but very insightful method of solution, which is called method of separation of variables. But method of separation of variables will not always work, and it works, we will see. I will derive the equations in details, and my teaching philosophy is very simple. Whatever I cannot derive at your level, I will not teach. Whatever I can derive at your level and make you understand, that only I will teach, because that is what you will learn. Not that you learn thousands of formula and reproduce without understanding where from it comes. That is not the education that I want to impart on you. So I will consider a simple case without any prejudice in mind. We will start and we will solve the entire problem. But I would like to let you know that method of separation of variable doesn't work always. So when method of separation of variable doesn't work always, when does it work and when it doesn't work? We will look into it in details, but one of the important requirements, like here, how many boundaries are there? There are 4 boundaries, right, in this domain. So in this kind of a problem, it is important that out of these 4 boundary conditions, at least we can have 3 homogeneous boundary conditions. So what is a homogeneous boundary condition? Homogeneous means right hand side equal to 0. I mean, of course, this is not a mathematical definition of what is homogeneous, but this is a practical way of looking into it. Something right hand side equal to 0, that we call as homogeneous. So here T0 may not be 0, right? So to convert this to 0, what we can do? We can just redefine, we can make theta is equal to T minus T0, right? We can define in this way. See, that is why deliberately these kinds of boundary conditions are given. I will show you that if one of these is relaxed, how will you do? Okay. So let us say this is T0, this is not equal to T0. How to solve that problem? I will give you some idea later on. But you can use a technique called a superposition to solve that problem using the method of separation of variable itself. But we will start with the simple one where we define theta is equal to T minus T0. The reason for defining this is to make all these 0 as boundary conditions. So the governing equation doesn't change. So in separation of variables, what we assume? So let us define the problem properly. So this is the governing differential equation. Boundary condition. So let us set up the x and y axis. At x equal to 0, theta is equal to 0. At x equal to a, theta is equal to 0. At y is equal to 0, theta is equal to 0. And at y is equal to b, theta is some function of x. Right? Okay. So governing equation and boundary condition, it defines the physical problem. So in separation of variables, what we do, we assume again, I am repeating that in all cases you cannot assume this. It depends on the boundary conditions, and we will see for what type of boundary conditions you do this. If you cannot assume this, what are the other techniques? There are other analytical techniques, somewhat more cumbersome, but it is more straightforward to solve these problems numerically. If you want to know how to solve these problems numerically, for that you have to study computational heat transfer and fluid mechanics, or CFD. Now, I mean, in all the books of heat transfer, there is some elementary computational or numerical part. If you are interested, you can look into that, but I believe that is too elementary. If you are really serious about learning how to solve these equations numerically, get hold of any CFD book, or you can look into the online video lectures of CFD. There is one NPTEL video lecture of CFD by me. You can look into that if you are interested, that how to solve these equations numerically. But I am not getting into that here. In most part of this course, we will try to go for analytical techniques. These are classical mathematical techniques which will give you a good grasp on the mathematics of the problem, which is necessary for many physical insights that you want to develop. So theta is equal to fx gy. So from that equation, what you can, so the second derivative with respect to x will mean f double dash g, right? Dash is derivative with respect to x, plus g double dash f is equal to 0. This is straight away from the governing differential equation. So you can write f double dash by f is equal to minus g double dash by g, right? See, if somebody asks you that why do you go for method of separation of variables, you cannot, you should not give this answer, because this was taught to me in the class. That is why I am interested about method of separation of variables. So method of separation of variables has one big issue, that is why it is so important. It allows you to convert a PDE to a ODE. It allows you to convert, if it is applicable, it converts a partial differential equation to an ordinary differential equation. And there are much more elaborate and commonly available techniques for solving ODEs than PDEs. So converting PDE to ODE, there are several other techniques. We will see later on that there is a method called a similarity transformation that also does it. We will look into it when we solve unsteady problems. But the whole idea is that there are whole classes of problems or whole classes of mathematical techniques which allow you to convert the partial differential equations to ordinary differential equations. So this is one attempt to do that. How we do that? This is a function of what? X, right? So this is function of x only. This is a function of what? Y only. A function of x only is equal to a function of y only. For a general function, it is possible only when each is a constant, right? Otherwise, it is not possible. So this implies each is equal to constant is equal to minus lambda square, say. So question is, and a very big question, is that why do we take this as minus lambda square and not plus lambda square, right? Always there are two ways of learning. One way of learning is, I mean, somehow you have got the idea. Another way of learning is learning through hard way, and that is not very bad actually. Sometimes we undermine it, but it is not very bad. So instead of minus lambda square, you may substitute plus lambda square and see that what kind of mess in which you come up with while solving the problem. But that is a hard way of learning, but an insightful way of learning is also there. So when you substitute it as minus lambda square, see what kind of solution you expect along x. Physical intuition. For this problem, what kind of solution you expect along x? You expect a periodic solution along x, because it is repeating again, right? So periodic means you have sine cosine type of variation. So if you put minus lambda square here, f double dash plus lambda square f equal to 0 will give sine and cos as the solution for f, right? So f will be c1 cos lambda x plus c2 sine lambda x, right? This is straightforward homogeneous second order ordinary differential equation. In high school level you have done this. Then what about g? So g will be exponential, right? E to the power x type of form, e to the power lambda x and e to the power minus lambda x. Sometimes for easy mathematical manipulation, we instead of using e to the power x, we use sine hyperbolic and cos hyperbolic x. Those are also linear combinations of e to the power x and e to the power minus x. Like you have solved fin problems. You have seen that in problems in fin, you could write the solution in terms of e to the power mx and e to the power minus mx. But usually it is written in terms of sine hyperbolic and cos hyperbolic just for mathematical manipulation. You can also write in terms of e to the power, there is no problem with that. So g is equal to c3 cos h lambda x plus y cos h lambda y plus c4 sin h lambda y. Now we will try to apply boundary conditions and solve for these constants to the extent possible. So let us give some numbers to the boundary condition. This is 1, this is 2, this is 3, this is 4. Boundary condition 1, at x equal to 0, theta equal to 0. Theta equal to 0 means f equal to 0. So at x equal to 0, f equal to 0. So which term will be 0? C1 will be 0, right? Now we apply the boundary condition number 3. At y equal to 0, theta equal to 0. So that means C3 equal to 0. Okay. So the solution has got rid of the constants C1, C3. You have two more. Now, if you apply the second boundary condition, at x equal to a, f equal to 0. So, at x equal to a, f equal to 0 means C2 sin lambda a equal to 0, right? C2 sin lambda a equal to 0. So, there are two possibilities. One is C2 equal to 0, another is sin lambda a equal to 0. But we do not take C2 equal to 0. Why? If we take C2 equal to 0, the total f becomes 0 and theta becomes 0. That is a trivial solution. The trivial solution is theta equal to 0 everywhere. So we are interested for a non-trivial solution, and so for non-trivial solution, sin lambda a equal to 0. This is called as eigenvalue problem in differential equations. Just like if you have eigenvalue problem in linear algebra, so for non-trivial solutions you have certain lambdas which give non-trivial solution to a solution of a system of algebraic equations. Here similarly you have a non-trivial solution, not algebraic equation but of a differential equation. So these are called as eigenvalue problems in differential equations. So you have sin lambda a equal to 0, so lambda a is equal to n pi, so lambda is equal to n pi by a. So how many possible values of lambda are there? Infinite number of possible values, depending on infinite number of possible values of n. So to mark that, we sometimes give a subscript n to lambda to indicate that there are numerous infinite number of values of lambda. So So theta, when we write, so it is basically C2 into C4, let us call it Cn sin lambda x sin h lambda y. What is Cn? Cn is C2 into C4. Now, for each value of lambda, you get a solution like this. How many such cases are there? Infinite number of such values of lambda are there. So, you will get infinite number of such terms, and the general solution is a sum of all those terms. Why? That is because of the linearity of the governing differential equation. If theta is equal to theta 1 is a solution, and theta is equal to theta 2 is a solution, then theta is equal to C1 theta 1 plus C2 theta 2 is also a solution for this. So, in this way, for lambda equal to lambda 1, you have a solution, lambda 2, lambda 3. In this way, all those terms sum together will also be a solution. That is because of the linearity of the governing differential equation. Okay? So, this is summation over n. So, now our task remains that how to find out this Cn, because once we find out this Cn, then that completes the solution of the problem. Only one constant means one set of constants, because Cn will be a function of n, of course. So, now we have only one boundary condition that we have yet not used. So, the boundary condition number 4. Theta is equal to fx at y equal to b. So, summation of Cn sin h lambda n b into sin lambda n x. Remember, this is what is fx. Now, how to get this Cn? So, we will see how to get this Cn. Let us consider this equation, which I have marked by arrow. So, this equation is okay. This equation, just I have expanded it in full form and used the subscript n. Okay, this equation. Now, what we do is we multiply this equation by Fm. Where m is not equal to n. Or a special case is there, when m equal to n, that is one value. In general, m may not be equal to n. Okay? So, we now integrate it with respect to x from x equal to 0 to x equal to a. So when we integrate this, we will use integration by parts, and quite obvious, because in integration by parts we have first function into integral of the second function. Second function we normally keep higher order derivative, because when we integrate, the order of the derivative comes down. So this is the first function, this is the second function. So first function into integral of the second, minus integral of derivative of first into integral of the second. Now apply the boundary condition. So this is a boundary term, right? What is the boundary condition? At x equal to 0, theta is 0, right? So f equal to 0. And at x equal to L also, theta is 0. So you can see this boundary term goes away. Had it been that at one of the boundaries instead of theta 0 it is d theta dx 0, then also this term would have been 0. Okay. So this term has become 0 and you are left with integral dfm dx into dfn dx . Now you swap m and n. So if you do that, you will get just swap m and n. Okay? And subtract. That if you subtract, you will get lambda n square minus lambda m square. Okay? So from here what can we conclude? We can conclude that integral fn fm dx from x equal to 0 to x equal to a, this is equal to 0 if m not equal to n, right? In general, to satisfy this, if m not equal to n, this term is not 0. So to make this 0, this is in general 0. But if m equal to n, that is not necessary. So this is not 0 if m is equal to n. This is called as orthogonality condition. So why such a name, orthogonality condition, out of Tom, Dick, Harry? Why orthogonality condition? So you are familiar with orthogonality of vectors, right? When you have two vectors, when do we say that two vectors are orthogonal to each other? When their dot product is 0, right? They are perpendicular to each other. So here in the functional space, instead of dot product, we talk about inner product. And this is here, instead of orthogonality of vectors, it is orthogonality of two functions. So their inner product, so when you say dot product of a vector, that is a special case of inner product. Basically, you are multiplying one component of one vector with the corresponding component of the other vector and adding it up. So here also, you are multiplying the function with its corresponding n index with m index. So when this is 0, then we say that it is an orthogonal function. So we will use that orthogonality here. So how can we use the orthogonality here? This is fnx, right? We will multiply both sides by fmx and integrate. So what we will do, multiply both sides by fmx and integrate. okay. So now the charm of using the orthogonality condition is that this summation will go away and you will be able to isolate Cn, because the integral is essentially integral on this function and the integral will be 0 for all m not equal to n. Only for one term when m equal to n the integral will be non-zero. So the instead of the summation the Cn itself can be isolated. So you will have Cn is equal to integral of 0 to a fx sin lambda n x dx divided by sin h lambda n b integral of sin square lambda n x dx. That completes the solution of the problem. So this integral you can very easily evaluate. You substitute sin lambda or lambda x equal to n pi by lambda n a equal to n pi. That was the value of lambda n, right? So lambda n is n pi by a. That you can substitute here, and here sin square theta you can write half into 1 minus cos 2 theta and integrate. Very simple integrations are there. Okay. So once you get the Cn, then basically you can write the solution in terms of an infinite series. Theta is equal to summation of Cn sin lambda n x sin h lambda n y. I tried to do it from as fundamentals as possible without referring to the Fourier series. But you can, if you use your familiarity with the Fourier series, you will see eventually the terms in the series that come, they quite clearly resemble with the terms in the Fourier series. Okay, so to summarize what we have studied today, we have discussed about what is the physical way of assessing whether a problem is one dimensional or two dimensional or three dimensional, steady or unsteady, and then we have invoked a simple problem of two dimensional steady state heat conduction and we have solved that problem. So we will stop here today and we will continue in the next class. Thank you.